Currently, apart from all my other work, my job is to bring in the latest technologies in Industry 4.0. How many of you have heard of Industry 4.0?
Don't know.
Okay,
Yes,
I'll speak about Industry 4.0 in a while. So my job profile now, I lead a team whose job is to bring in Industry 4.0 to existing customer engagements, particularly in high-tech manufacturing areas. Which means, yeah, Biswa, could you please mute yourself? I think there's a background noise. Biswanath?
Okay, sir. Okay.
So my job is to bring in these Industry 4.0 flavors to our existing customer engagement. And because I deal with a lot of high-tech and manufacturing customers, and with a background in supply chain management analytics, I find it easier to apply the principles, the various Industry 4.0. Industry 4.0 is nothing but automation, intelligent automation, analytics, cloud computing, edge computing, whatever you hear about, blockchain, whatever you hear about, to bring in those artifacts into the current scenario or whatever industry you are operating in. So that is my background. And which is why when I was looking at the supply chain management analytics as a course, role of IT in SCM, the topic that I'm going to cover today is something that attracted me and I felt that I could contribute. And I hope I will. At the end of this course, you'll become richer with the experience that I'll pertain to this particular session. That's about me. I hold an engineering degree. Then, of course, I had an experience in pure play software development. Then I did my MBA specializing in operations and finance. And then on, it has been a journey throughout in the same organization where I was working for, with holding these various roles, and the current role that I hold, as I said, you is leading a team in Industry 4.0 practices, particularly in high tech and manufacturing. So let's start. That's about me. Let's start our session. Okay, how to present? Yeah. Is my screen visible to everyone now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay, so I just want to, you know, sometimes it's very important. I'll start with a very philosophical angle to it. Okay. Whenever a larger philosophical angle, whenever you are, you know, in a situation of difficulty or you feel that this world, it's a life, you know, life lesson rather. When you believe that you know nothing is going right in your life now, you know you don't have what you need, you just try for 5 or 10 minutes to think about life without whatever you have, right? Generally we do that, right? When we whine about life, oh, things are not getting right now, I'm not you know in a happy state of mind, I do not have what I need or what I desire. It's important to step back, okay, and do this little exercise, and you imagine your life without, you know, having what you have now. For example, last 4 months I've been working from home, okay, and my wife also works, but she doesn't have the luxury of working from home. She has to go out, and I was whining that, you know, I was complaining that. You know, I don't have the luxury of going out. I'm simply bored. You know, I'm missing the whole office experience. And she gave me this lesson actually, and she said, "Can you imagine people who do not, because you're working in an industry which offers you the luxury today of working from home, but there are people who cannot work from home today, and they do not have work outside as well." Do you have that? You know, it really jolted me out from that phase that, yeah, I'm really in a very lucky state, thanks to God, thanks to the whole system of things, that I am in a situation where I can work from home and still have the luxury of complaining that, oh, I'm working from home. Correct. That's a philosophical angle. I'll tell you why I put this across. Today, what I always also believe, I had a brilliant professor, Professor Indranil Chakraborty, and he was a professor in complexity science. He lives in Pondicherry. He teaches as per his will. Okay, he doesn't teach for as a profession. He lives in Pondicherry. But whenever he does a class, even if I've done it in my in my college, I always go back to him and listen to him. Okay. So he said a philosophical point. Okay, please pause me if I'm getting too abstract or something. Pause me and says, Shubhra, we didn't understand what you're saying. Because as I said, this is a discussion that we're going for. So what he said is, in this universe, everything happens by design. He took a very philosophical angle. He said, in this universe, everything happens as a design. You see World War II, it happened with certain factors in place. World War II wouldn't have been World War II without the development of the atomic bomb. World War II, or for that matter, globalization wouldn't have happened without information technology or internet coming into force. It was in 1970s that internet was developed as a US military, military strategic operation called as ARPANET, for people who are enthusiasts in technology. And then it suddenly burst into something which we call as internet. Nobody envisaged that ARPANET would actually become a commercial and public network, which we call as internet today. And globalization happened just after that. So in universe, everything happens according to a design. Today, we are in corona times. We're all holed up inside our homes. We are all frightened, because if we catch the COVID, then what happens to us? What happens to our families? But yet we are living, most of us, we are living, we are having our food, we are doing everything from our phones, also complaining about working from home like me. Can you imagine this world if we had these things in place? Just imagine, just step back and imagine that today, instead of having a laptop, of having Google Meet on that laptop, of having very cheap data plans. I don't know, I belong to a generation, because I started my engineering in early 2000s. I belong to a generation where, I had to pull out the plug out of that, phone, and then insert it into my computer, dial in, and then access the internet. And at the end of the month, the phone bills used to come astronomical. And my dad used to say, oh, what happened? This internet is really taking up a lot of money. How many of you experienced that scenario in this? I think, Malikas, how many of you have experienced that?
We are the designers.
Yeah. So can you imagine today we have a single G phone which doesn't have access to internet. We have dial-in connections. We have Windows 95. We don't have special collaborative software like the one that we are having today. And, there is no concept of home delivery and tracking it. Home delivery was there, but it was like if you know somebody in a restaurant. You know somebody in the restaurant and the home delivery would happen for those high and mighty. But you don't have home delivery as easy as Swiggy now. Can you imagine? And how difficult it would become to live in times of corona if these situations didn't exist. We didn't have a 4G phone. We didn't have dirt cheap internet. We didn't have specialized collaborative software that makes you do a lot of things. You could download many things at a whim, and you have almost entire world at your fingertips. And that is where universe, nature, superpower, whatever you call it, or conspiracy. Some people call it as a universal conspiracy. Corona happened. In fact, I WhatsApp is the base of all knowledge now. So I came across, there was one person who said that, this corona has been engineered. We should not, of course, take names of countries now. Corona has been engineered to jolt the world into the next level of automation, the next level of, digital economy. Anyways, that's all conspiracy theories and all. But what I'm saying, the point I brought to you here is technology today has become the core of our lives. It is not, in, it's not in, whether you laugh over it or you cry over it, that's different. But it is not enough to say that technology is a part of our lives today. That's an understatement. Technology is the core of our life today. Okay, you love it or you hate it. Okay, you tell, I need a digital detox, right? They say, take it in a week, you take 2 days off. Of your mobile phones or your social media. You say, I want a digital detox. That shows to what extent digital or technology, digital is a concept, technology is real. So technology has become core to your, you know, to your existence. So how can supply chain management, which is nothing but, you know, bringing the need and the need and the actual good and services together. It's that's as simple as that. I have a need, there is a good or that there is a service that satisfies my need. Who brings it together? The supply chain management network, right? So in supply chain network, I would not be wrong to say that technology is the core of it. If there is no technology today, there would be no supply chain network today. That is where I start my premise or my preamble to whatever we are going to learn today is the role of IT in supply chain management. So I would like to pause here and say, probably it should become how core is IT or information systems in supply chain network. Okay, there is no role. It is the main role now. Sorry, I'll come next. I understand. I have come in. This session is after 4 to 5 sessions of supply chain management analytics. So I need not go to it. But my professor used to use a word which is called as housekeeping. You know, before you start a session, you keep some things in place. So this is something that is known to you. But I just want to keep things in perspective before we get into the real thing. Supply chain management, as I said, is bringing your need. You know, you have a need as a consumer. Sorry, I'll. Yeah. So supply chain management is bringing your need as a consumer, and there's a good and services at one end. And you are bringing the supplier to the goods and services through a majority of things, through a majority of steps to the consumer. So you have material flow, there is a consumer orders and a material flows, consumer pays money. So there is a material flow or whatever, or services flow, you can say it in case of services, from the supplier to the consumer. And there is a money flow because there is a remuneration, money flow from the consumer to the supplier. It is as simple as that. There's nothing big here. I just wanted to put things in perspective. But in real life, this becomes a little more complex, okay? So there are multiple customers, okay? And the customer orders a good or a service, which is an aggregation of many suppliers, okay? For example, if you say, let's say I order food from Swiggy, okay, which I'm going to do now after this session is over. Me ordering food from Swiggy, Swiggy is one of the suppliers, right? And in fact, saying that supplier, manufacturer, distributor doesn't always come in this order. This order is also changing, right? It might change on the circumstances. So Swiggy orders from different, when the restaurant prepares the order for me, the restaurant has multiple suppliers. There could be a supplier for chicken, fish and eggs. There could be a supply for dairy products. There's a supply for oil, meat, oil and masalas. And each of these suppliers might have different frequency of supplying depending on the need. For example, for a restaurant, the frequency of supplying rice, oil, cooking gas is less frequent than supply of meat, fish, chicken, eggs and dairy, because which are perishable. No brainer, no rocket science I'm talking here. As I said, once again, I'm putting things into perspective that how complex it becomes. But hello, just I just want a time check. Could someone tell me that he is following what I'm saying? Just a yes would do from any one of you. Hello, am I there with everyone?
Yes. Written in chat box, sir. They are writing in the chat box. Amit Sinha has written yes.
Okay, thank you. Oh, I'm not able to see. Hold on. I think I'll make it.
In right side there is a chat box, sir.
Yes, I know, sir. I'm looking. I'm more used to Zoom, so this is what is okay. Just a second, sir. Oh, okay. Audible, yeah. Okay. So in this simple or complex view of supply chain management, there is a traditional view on supply chain management, right? What are the goals of a supply chain manager in a traditional setup? There's a focus on competition because you want to be one step ahead of your competition. Supply chain contains far more than the required inventory, okay, because you don't trust your competition. Because when you are in a situation of competition, you don't trust. Products are handled too many times because you don't trust technology either. And physical couriers struggle to maintain costly equipment on slim margins because you again don't trust, okay. And no player has enough information to synchronize and optimize the entire chain. So you are, you know, the Lala kind of a business. I'm sorry if there is any Lala out here. You're in a Lala kind of a business, one of my marketing professors used to say. So the Lala business, you have a very traditional, you don't trust, you want to, you preserve information, you don't share your equipment, you don't share your technology, you don't share the information that you have. We only share in Lala kind of a business, you only share the pricing information because you want to maintain a cartel. Have you seen, the gold gold jewelers? They share only the pricing information, but where they source their gold jewelry from, who is the person, or what technology they do, they don't share, but they maintain the pricing. You know, in Bhubaneswar, for example, if you go to any jewelry shop, all of them would be selling gold at a rate of 5,500 per gram. Because there is a cartel that they maintain. Because if somebody sells, let's say, 5,000 per gram, then all others would go bankrupt. So there's a cartel, there's a biradri kind of a system, and you only share price information. But because of that, you know, a very limited amount of trust that is there, which is why you only share little information. When the gold jewelry business comes down, it comes down like anything. Just a little bit of an information. I think people who are dealing with the financial world, today gold is running at an all-time high. It's around 55,000 per 10 grams. But the gold jewelry business in India is dying. Okay, can you imagine that? The price of gold per 10 gram is at an all-time high, 55,000. But the gold jewelry business is dying. Okay, the jewelry shop owners are not able to pay their staff salaries. There is no sales. Nothing is there. I will tell you why commodity trading and commodity carteling is a problem in SCM. That's a topic for another day. I'll not delve into that, but just an information. Here, in the traditional view, I'd like to pause and ask somebody, what could be the problems? If you are focusing on competition, what could be the problem? Could anybody answer? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Would anybody answer? You are able to see, right? What I'm sharing, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Ma'am, I just made a just a second, ma'am. I just made a statement that in the traditional view of supply chain management, traditional way of managing a supply chain, there is a lot of focus on competition and supply chain. What could be the problem? Why, you know, we always say, right, that we should be competitive, but a focus on competition, what problems it could have? Could you please tell me?
Maybe decrease in quality of the product, sir?
No, not necessary. Would anybody answer? You're near that, ma'am. I'm not saying you're wrong. You're near that. But a little more acute an answer. That was an obtuse answer. Anybody else would like to try?
Change in needs.
Well, not really. Let me answer this for you. See, what happens is, there is a beautiful book, you can note that down. That book is called as Super Cooperators. Okay. So we heard, you know, we have come up hearing one thing, you know, survival of the fittest. You have to live in a competitive world, right? You have stories that how those species, survival of the fittest is one adage that was coined by Charles Darwin. That if you are the fittest person, you survive, right? So dinosaurs couldn't survive, but cockroaches survived because they were the fittest, or they could adapt themselves to the changes. But this book, Super Cooperators, put forth a better theory than that. They say that only those species of animals who coopted with their surroundings, who had a symbiotic relationship with the surrounding, they survived more than those species of animals who were more into predatory nature, who were so unsymbiotic in their behavior that the ecosystem just couldn't handle them, right? I don't want to name organizations, but as supply chain management organizations that initially grow a lot because they're very competitive, right? They do not share information. They do not help the other organizations grow. In the long run, what happens, it's a public forum. I'll not be able to take the names of organizations in a derivative manner, so I cannot share the names. So in the long run, what happens, the ecosystem, instead of celebrating you, actually fears you. Have you seen a monopolistic environment? In a monopolistic environment, the small players are actually afraid of you. So, because you are simply eating up, you are competitive, you just want to eat up competition. In the process, you don't share information. The ecosystem fears you, right? You don't add anything to the industry. If I'm an IT company in an IT industry, if I'm not adding something to the industry, then the industry doesn't respect me. Industry doesn't think that I am a player or an organization that is going to be of any value to the industry, and slowly my space in the industry shrinks. The same goes for traditional supply chain management or the Lala Biradri kind of a business. You closely guard information. You don't share technology, you don't share practices. In the end, you are only eating into each other's business. The problem with focusing on competition is you are not growing your business, but rather you are eating each other's business, right? Cannibalizing. It's a cannibalizing business, what we call. And that is the problem with a traditional view. And because you are always untrustworthy, you're untrustful of others, you contain lot of inventory, you don't use technology, and you do not have enough information that help your business grow. You are simply eating into others' businesses. Okay? As I said, the consequences. So there is a high level of uncertainty. You don't know what other person is doing. There is erratic variations of demand. There is a lack of process integration with partners. Hence, there is a need for integrated information systems. If you see how the Amul story played out, you know, Amul as an organization actually helps other organization or other dairy organizations across the country, or in fact across the world, to adapt practices from Amul. If you are, let's say you are trying to set up a dairy farm or a dairy products factory in Odisha, or for that matter any area where there is no penetration of dairy products, you can go to Amul. They will train you, they will give you the technology, they will give you the know-how, they will tell you the practices, everything. Everything is open. Reason? They want dairy industry as a practice to grow, because the more the practice grows, it is Amul itself which gets enriched, and hence Amul is a very respected dairy organization, dairy products organization in the entire world. What happens? Amul has expanded itself from just a dairy product company to a dairy industry knowledge company. Can you imagine that? So from a traditional view, which closely guards information, a modern supply chain management, which wants to be respected in the industry, has to have an open culture of sharing, cooperating, and collaborating in terms of information. And how do you collaborate? How do you share? How do you optimize? With the help of IT and IS, information technology and information services. Pause. Are there any questions? Because I went too much into a monologue. Are there any questions here? Any doubts? Any disagreements?
No, sir.
Okay. Mallikarjun sir, do you have any questions here? Do you disagree? Because I believe you're working, so do you believe or
no questions?
Yeah, but you said trust is best. Yes. Yeah, I just saw the chat. I'm sorry. So since I made a case for supply chain management, why IT and IS? Because you provide information availability and visibility. Okay? Enable a single point of contact for data. And since I belong to Industry 4.0, I'll give a lot of insights into data. Jayashi, you'll enjoy it, and of course others as well. Allow decision based on total supply chain information. You have an end-to-end view of the supply chain. And enable collaboration with partners. I said in the earlier slide. So that is the role of IT and IS. These four are the roles of IT and IS in supply chain management. But again, you know, I'm talking about present IT IS role. There's one phase where I'll get into, you know, what needs to be done still, what is still yet, in its infancy stages, as far as role of IT and IS in supply chain management goes. Usually, you know, it started off with transaction processing in supply chain management, you know, material loading, material unloading, dash, you would know that, inventory filing. So there's, when you need transaction processing, you use IT and IS, but it's simple automation. Data sharing, collaboration, right? Across your partners in supply chain management, you need IT and IS. By the way, I disagree. I always say you must always say IT and IS. Okay. That's my personal belief, because IT is a standalone, and when it is converted into a useful practice, it becomes IS, information systems or information services. I call it information services. That's my belief system, you know. So transaction processing is where automation takes place. Collaboration is where you as an organization and your partners, your customers are able to see and find where the materials are, or what is the state of materials, or what is the extent of materials that are present out there. That's collaboration, order tracking and delivery. And thanks to Swiggy, everybody knows how useful order tracking and delivery is, right? So these are the major areas in which, you know, I will say last 10 years, supply chain management has been operating in. It's no rocket science. I'll come to the interesting part a little later. In the next slides, next 4 to 5 slides, I'll cover those existing components of supply chain management information systems. Okay. So the first, Jayashree knows, it is ERP systems, the heart of an organization. Okay. So if your body is an entire supply chain management system, the ERP is one which is a repository of materials, sales, you know, everything. So ERP, just a second, I will. Honestly speaking, ERP started off with purchasing and material management. Right, Jayashree?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so it is material requirements planning is where ERP started off with. And because it is cannibalizing, so it started to get into the first way. The first was purchasing and financial management and material requirement planning. Then it started integrating itself into sales. And then inventory. And then now it is getting into business analytics and CRM. However, I have personally seen major customers of my organization, major manufacturing companies, not using the same ERP that they used for material requirement planning for CRM. Okay. Because generally it's like, you know, you purchase a car to travel, or let's say you purchase a fridge, refrigerator to store items. But you know, nowadays refrigerators come with internet facilities, speaker, television, whatnot. You don't buy that, right? You purchase a refrigerator for storing items, you purchase a television for you know, for viewing content, and you have a smartphone to view internet. I personally believe, and as a consultant, as a business architect, that is what we generally advise customers, that you purchase systems which are the world leaders in that particular area. And today there is enough of collaborative technology so that the data can pass from one system to another, right? I talk about SAP. SAP has a brilliant CRM in place. SAP Analytics is also good, but still people you know, use SAP for material management and inventory and use Cognos for dashboarding. Jayashree, would you disagree with me or agree with me? Hello?
Yes, sir, I agree with you.
Because have you ever seen, or you know, have you ever seen an organization, mostly you might have seen, but most organizations use multiple systems. They don't use the entire ERP to do everything. Okay, that's a topic for another day. That's for systems planning and architecture. I'll not get into that. But ERP is the heart. Okay, ERP, generally you see everything else. But the fact is that the heart of ERP system is you manage inventory, financial management, the general ledger kind of thing, and the purchasing part, procurement part. In fact, let me tell you one of my experiences. 5 years back, I will not take the name of the auto major. It was a major automobile company which had an ERP system in place, but they were managing their procurement and their materials, everything on Excel sheets. Okay, so I was leading a team to you know, create a system for managing their procurement and integrating it into their ERP. So that's how it is. But they had an ERP, they had purchased that ERP for themselves. Anyways, that's happened. That happens in large organizations. So there is an IT department that purchases a system, but the other departments don't know that there is one such system in place. They don't use it also. Has that happened with any one of you? Have you experienced people who are working in the industry?
Yeah, there are a lot more places where it happens because a lot of these departments work in silos. So
exactly, of course. Exactly. So the classic case of not collaborating and not sharing of enough information, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
I'm just putting things in place. You might be knowing all this. So you have the ERP system. You have the transport management system, which provides more visibility into shipments and orders. You see where your cargo is getting handled, how it is getting handled. There are systems in place. generally, you manage it using ERP, but there are places where there is no ERP in place. You have inventory management systems which exist in silos, and you use that to calculate your inventory carrying cost, to forecast your inventory, return, reverse logistics, whatever you call, inventory valuation, visibility, demand inventory, and inventory pricing. So in this four or five slides, I'm just enumerating out what are the technologies that happen or IT technologies that exist in supply chain management. Okay.
Sir, what are these silos or something that you are telling about?
Silos.
Means what, sir?
Silos means isolated systems. Silos means isolated systems. So silos, suppose you are working in a department, what happens generally, I'll just explain. See what
Okay.
happens in a large organization, let's say a large organization like Reliance Industries, okay?
Okay.
So the IT department would actually procure, let's say, the latest SAP, because you've worked in SAP, the latest SAP component for, let's say, business analytics, okay? And let's say the purchasing procurement department doesn't know that it has already, the same company has already purchased the SAP component for business analytics. And because it doesn't have funds to purchase its own analytics software, it keeps on doing analytics using Excel sheets. But whereas, and it will keep on complaining, I don't have a dashboard, I don't have anything, because there is not a single place, I'm just giving an example, there is not a single place where the IT department can say to all the departments that, guys, I have bought a new analytics component of SAP, you take advantage of it. And the procurement department doesn't even know. So that is the case of silos, SILOS. That's what generally happens in organizations where communication is not frequent or communication channels are very cumbersome. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Made myself clear? Yeah.
हेलो सर, आपने एक कहा ITIS इनेबल सिंगल पॉइंट ऑफ डाटा. सर प्लीज इसको थोड़ा डिफाइन कर दीजिए ना.
ओके, आई वुड हैव डिफाइंड इट लेटर, बट आई विल डिफाइन इट,
ओके सर.
आई
ओके सर.
जस्ट जस्ट आई मे नो योर नेम प्लीज,
दीप्ति.
दीप्ति. दीप्ति, आई विल कम बैक टू यू बिकॉज आई हैव अ स्लाइड ऑन दिस, हाउ इट,
ओके सर.
या सो आई विल नॉट, बिकॉज द फ्लो विल ब्रेक, बट आई विल कम बैक टू यू. इंटरेस्टिंग क्वेश्चन. So inventory management system, as I said, it's another system. Sometimes it is integrated with ERP, sometimes it is not. Then you have the electronic data interchange systems. Okay. In electronic data interchange systems, what happens, the Lala Biradri kind of a business, I've been, if somebody is into that business, you would really get angry on me the more I talk about Lala and Biradri kind of business. In fact, Hawala is one example of data interchange, right? How many of you agree? Hawala is one way of data interchange only, though it is illegal. Hello?
We don't know about Hawala.
Yes.
It's
Hello?
only in the films I have seen. We don't know real about
The
Hawala.
Hawala is a simple way. Unfortunately, what happens, it is used by criminals and underworld people who want to evade taxes. Okay. So it's an informal way of data interchange, right? So just we should not,
Not
it's
only
legal.
underworld, but even politicians use it.
Yeah, of course, when you don't want it to be on record, you use Hawala, right? So it's important to understand what happens. So if you pay me money here, I'll tell to my counterpart in Dubai that he has paid me money. This money is mine. So there is a trust-based data interchange that happens. Okay. The only point is that this data interchange is hidden from legal authorities because you want this money for some illegal purposes. Okay. But in a legal world, what happens? The buyer and there's a seller. There is a paper-based information, right? What happens if you see many, in fact, they exist in India today also. A businessman in India, he sim a businessman in Odisha simply calls up a phone, picks up a phone and calls his calls the traditional family business in Rajasthan, ki itne itne rupee ka maal bhijwa do, marble bhijwa do. And the other person, he simply sends the marble from Rajasthan to Odisha. And the interchange of orders and everything happens over paper, over trust, right? So that is life without EDI. Okay, so you have two organizations, buyer and seller, and there's a purchase request. There is a receiving department, there's a manufacturing department, if you see, but the interchange happens between them, be it on paper or be it on base of trust. Okay, but in electronic data interchange, what happens? If you see, Jayesh, you tell what happens in an ERP or MM system. There is a purchase request, there's a requisition. The money gets deducted from the finance department, from the general ledger. Everything happens in a seamless and automatic manner. Okay? So that is what we call as electronic data interchange. Before, it used to happen in, to paper-based. And today, in using electronic data interchange, it happens via the internet or the electro. You know, there's a technology stamp over it. I'll just give some exciting point of view. There is one technology which is very recent, which has changed this electronic data interchange process. Can anybody name it? You know, it's very new, but you have been hearing about it. Can anybody give a try? It's a single word. It's a new age technology.
Sir, can you please repeat the question?
You see, I'm talking about EDI, okay, where, you know, we make a request via the system, electronic data interchange. The EDI capable computer passes on the message to the seller. From the seller, the sales department, you know, makes the manufacturing, shipping department happens. You receive the shipping order and it comes to your inventory and warehousing. The money gets deducted from your finance department, from your general ledger, and gets automatically added to your finance department, right? So these data interchanges happens through internet or LAN cable, correct? Correct, Jayashree?
Yes, sir.
But recently, there is always a danger of tampering of these data interchanges. There is always a danger of someone hacking into these data interchanges. Recently, there is a technology which, in a very free and cheap manner, makes these data interchanges indelible, untamperable. What is that technology name? Is my question understandable by all?
Yes, sir.
Rudram sir has mentioned it is IMPS.
And else? Anything else?
UPI, sir?
No, UPI is just money transfer. Okay, I'll answer it. Blockchain. How many of you have heard of blockchain?
I heard, sir.
Yeah, so blockchain, yeah, IMPS, or these are all, I understand, Rudra. Mallikarjun, you are right. So I just saw, yes, it is blockchain. So blockchain, as a technology, if you can read, it is making the data interchanges, data exchanges, electronic data interchange or electronic data exchange, as they call it, much more, secure, transparent, and you cannot change the transaction. So read about it, blockchain, in supply chain management, blockchain in financial transaction. That's a topic for another day. I covered ERP, I covered material procurement, we covered transport management systems, we covered EDI. Then there is distribution requirement planning. Again, this is one component of ERP, but some organization use a different component for planning your distribution. So these are the IT systems that are in place. Of course, supply chain management, tracking of materials, is it possible so easily without a barcode? No, right? If you've seen the Amazon delivery agent, what he does, he simply scans a barcode and the entire picture is complete where the material is moving from, right?
QR code.
Yeah, barcode or QR code, whatever you call it. A little more advancement of a barcode is radio frequency identification. The advantage of radio frequency identification over barcode, say radio frequency, you'll say, why is he talking about RFID and barcode? RFID and barcode are the very basics of any ITIS system in supply chain management. Otherwise, you can't track materials. Otherwise, you have to manually feed materials, right? But RFID is a more costlier technology. But advantage about RFID is, in many cases, RFID can be automated. You don't need even a person to, you know, scan those barcodes. Or for that matter, sometimes barcodes can be obliterated. You know, weather conditions are there. You sometimes find barcodes can't be read into. But RFID advantage is that it is, it's not that it is not indestructible, but it takes a lot of more effort and more, you know, intense weather conditions to destroy RFID tag than it takes to destroy a QR code or a barcode. And mostly many organizations like Alibaba or Walmart, they don't even need a person to scan the RFID tag. The moment it passes through a gate, you know, the material movement is recorded. Correct? What we spoke about are the software components. Then we'll talk about software agents, and that there we'll listen from Mallikarjun sir. Software agents are those in a supply chain management. What is the difference between software components and software agents? Software components play a role, but software agents don't play a direct role, but they play a peripheral role, and they read, they observe, they gather that data. So, for example, you have data mining agent. As the supply chain movements are happening, data mining software agents gather data for business analytics. There are shopping bots, they're buyer agents. You know, Amazon, the front end of Amazon, that's an agent. That is not a part of the supply chain management system, but that is an agent that helps the buyer choose the product and pay. So that is a buyer agent. You know, today every shopping list, or for that matter, most shopping portals have got a chatbot which advise you what to pay. You know, you can call up IVR system and they will aid you to return logistics, reverse logistics. But those are the peripheral components, and hence they are called as a personal agents. And then you have the monitoring and supply chain management, the quality control department, the, you know, the material safety department. So these don't play a direct role, but they play agency role in terms of helping something happen without playing a direct role in that particular format. So I'll just pause here. Mallikarjun sir, would you please speak something more about what agents that you use and develop? Can we hear from you?
Yes.
Yeah.
See, I'm into consultation, and American-based this thing is using my concept.
Mm-hmm.
It's an intelligent agent where it acts as a human agent,
mm-hmm.
and it thinks intelligently, bargains, or say in contracts, and gets the details, and also acts as a officer of another company. So it is a part of integration of supply chain management into manufacturing, into logistics, and also into customers.
Correct.
So, for example, a customer uses a particular product for purchasing.
Mm-hmm.
You can see online, again, that advertisements or that particular type of products are advertised in his mobile or, say, computer.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, Google is doing already this.
But
as an agent for supply chain management and logistics, still Google has not used it.
Mm-hmm.
My concept is to use these programs, small programs, to enact as a agent instead of human being, where human being is biased. For example, I am there. So I am biased as an Indian.
Correct.
Whereas that agent, it doesn't have any bias. So automatically the trust is built into the system.
Very good, very good, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. So you agree to this concept of dividing the IT and IS systems into core systems and agent systems? Do you get the concept,
sir? Integrating. Yeah. Here for understanding, okay. But you have to integrate it.
Exactly, of course, unless you don't integrate, you cannot converse with each other, right?
Yes, but the role
is different.
A role is different, of course. Role
exactly.
is different.
So that is what
but
I want.
Integration is required, yes.
Of course. So that is what I wanted to say. That, you know, when you are, because we are looking at Mallikarjun sir, we are looking at the people here are going to play an important role in tomorrow's supply chain management scenario. So we are looking at, so you must be discerning that what is a core supply chain management IT system and what is an agent IT system. What is important and what is, you know, in IT industry, we call something as must have, good to have and nice to have.
Yes.
So the components are must have. Yes, sir. You were saying something. I interrupted you.
Yes. So now it's not limited to IT industry.
Exactly.
Because of integration of supply chain, everybody, mechanical engineers, industrial engineers, civil engineers, they have to accept the IT and also integrate their knowledge of IT in detail. So that the customer becomes ultimate king.
At the end of the day. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yes,
we are on the same page. That's so nice. So, I spoke about Mallikarjun sir because he spoke of agents. Everybody else is comfortable with the idea of what is the difference between IT systems, which are core supply chain management systems, and IT systems, which are agent systems. Everybody is comfortable with the idea?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Okay. Now, but I am not happy. I spoke about what is there. Okay. I will speak about what could happen. Okay. Before I go to what could happen. So, till now, I spoke about what is there. I made you understand what are the components, what are the different kind of components. No, please. I will now speak about what could happen or what is happening, which is a futuristic technology. Okay. Before I start there, I would like to show a small video. Okay. Let's see what is a small video. Okay. What that video is. Hello, I don't think the audio is visible to all, right? Audio is not, it's not.
Yeah, audio is not coming.
Oh, hold on. A second, please. Happened. Just give me a second, please. Just check what is the problem. Is it visible to everyone now?
Not yet.
Hold on, please. Just a second, please. You in these times, it is it is very dangerous to talk about China or admire China in today's times. But so I took the risk of Walmart is everybody knows about it, but Alibaba is a group which I really respect. Very dangerous to talk in today's times. But sorry for that. Please listen. It's audible to all, right?
My voice is not there, sir. Only audio, video is there. Audio is not there.
Still, audio is not there.
No, no, sir.
You have to share the screen.
Yeah, please share the link.
Okay, I'll share the link. Achha, tell me one thing. Is this audio? Oh God, there is some problem. The Google Meet. Use system audio. Just hold on. I'll. Just a second. I'll share the link, of course. Is this audio enabled? Is the audio in? Are you able to hear the audio?
No, sir.
Are you able? This audio you're able to hear, huh?
No, this one also not able to hear. You can
play. You're able to see the video, right?
Yes.
Just hold on. Have you ever seen a video on Google Meet? Oh, hold on. Listen to your files. Settings. Audio microphones. Select stereo mix. Okay. Things. You do. Audio. MIC stereo mix. Okay.
Being in my mind.
Yes, sir. Now,
this is the place we start. 18 people have dreamed. The Alibaba service should help in millions of small business, young people to really.
I'm not able to see the video, sir.
Sir, aapki voice nahi aa rahi hai.
Realize their dreams, all the tough decisions we have to make. But we know, without these tough days, we can never be today. Alibaba was born in Jack's apartment 20 years ago. Since then,
we have transformed from an e-commerce company into a digital economy that is one of a kind in the world. Our digital economy has expanded to include cloud computing, financial services, logistics, local services, digital media, and entertainment. Our core competency is finding the right chemistry between technology and business, which has culminated in the creation of the Alibaba Business Operating System. Our founding mission was to make it easy to do business anywhere. Looking ahead, we will continue to build a better future through innovation and creativity. We are a
big game station,
but that's not enough. It is more important that we are a good company. We target 2036, which to serve 2 billion consumers, support 10 million profitable businesses on our platform, create jobs. Our long-term goal is to be a company that at least 102 years. That milestone would mean Alibaba has successfully spent 3 centuries. An achievement very few can
make.
We choose to create our own path. We believe in the future. We know the way.
Okay. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes.
I think if that is coming, then this is not coming. So we'll interchange. I have just one more video. We'll show the case it later. So you see, how many of you have heard about Alibaba? You know what Alibaba, what's a powerful part of Alibaba? It's business as a service. Very powerful concept, right? So, you know, the joke about Alibaba is that you, if you want to tell what cannot be done, that is easier to do in Alibaba than to make a list of what can you do in Alibaba. You can arrange for finances, you can arrange for a lot of things in Alibaba. It is, so what is the secret of Alibaba? Okay. It has bought in digital, it is thinking of a digital economy. It is not thinking of itself as a supply chain management company or an e-commerce company. It is thinking of itself as a digital economy. The point that I would bring in before I go to the next slide, and Ditya, I'll come to your answer there. You know, the role of IT and IES in supply chain management can only be successful if you have a vision for IT and IES. You do not want IT, IES or information technology in supply chain management just as, are ye to karna hi hai. No. It has to be a vision for you. Is everybody getting what I'm saying?
Yes.
There has to be a mission and goal for your information technology to succeed. Otherwise, it will become another case where you are operating silos. Bhai, mujhe ek ERP kharidna hai. I just purchased that ERP for many million dollars and it's lying unused. Because you don't have a vision. Correct? So, I'll just go to the next part of my slide. As I said, see, now your IT and IES is in place. As I said, I'm not happy with whatever I've told right now because I was speaking about what is happening now. But the job of this particular session is to take you to the future. What will happen in future? how a role of IT and IS in supply chain management is going to change. So I just told you a lead data ladder, right? So because you have an IT system in place, because you have ERP system, transportation management system, decision support system, you have distribution systems, you have tracking systems, you have RFID and everything else, you have data, you have enormous amounts of data. I didn't add electronic data interchange systems. Now you have to convert the data into analytics. You have to gain insights out of those data. That is the next level, which happened during early 2000s, right? Then slowly we go to the next level where we apply intelligence to the data. So instead of just having analytics, which tells what is the support area or what is the, you know, what is the cost or what is the profit of everything, or, you know, where the cost is going high or where the cost is going low, we'll have a system which is artificial intelligence, which will predict what will be the next cost. Okay. What, in fact, we are working on how many of you have heard about this, about something called as product engineering, product lifecycle management? You've heard about product lifecycle management?
Yes.
So we are working, you know, there is a group that is working on a new age product lifecycle management. So what happens, you know, in general areas in a manufacturing company, the product is envisaged, the product is designed, the product is prototyped, and then it goes to production. And then only you realize how whether the product is competitively priced and be competitively priced or not. Because sometimes, you know, on a design table, the product is, you know, designed with a lot of fancy things in mind. But when you actually produce it, even prototype is easy. But when you actually produce it, you know that whether the, you know, it is feasible to sell it in the market or not. How many of you follow this auto expos? How many of you follow auto expos? Yeah, if you see, there's a lot of concept cars that are on display, but very few of them actually come into production. Because while, you know, making a prototype is easy, okay, but when you are mass producing it, then only you realize that whether, the cost of producing such a car is feasible or not, whether it is competitive or not, right? The same happens in, we are working on AI. There is one particular group that is working on artificial intelligence to product design, where at a design level itself, using artificial intelligence, we can predict the cost of producing that particular manufacturing product. So as I said, we go from data. We go from data to analytics to artificial intelligence to machine learning, which is, you know, creating self-correcting systems, right? So if there is a supply chain management, and, you know, something has failed, the inventory forecasting has failed, then the system must be capable of self-correcting its forecasting algorithm. So there I'll come to Jayashree. Jayashree, you have worked in SPSS, right? In SPSS, if you have a model, you have created a forecasting model and it is not working, then you have to yourself go and change the forecasting model, right? Right, Jayashree? I think I'm missing Jayashree.
Yes, she is not there, sir.
She is not there. But in using machine learning, the model will self-correct itself. Okay. Then, so this is the ladder. You know, this is how you go. So when I was talking about supply chain management IT components, I was talking about data and analytics. The future is, you know, applying, Mallikarjun sir said, he has applied intelligence to it. So it is using AI and machine learning, and then only you get into the leader segment. Okay. Now, this is one slide where, the single viewpoint of data, as Dipti said, is coming into picture. So here, let us take a 5-minute break. I think we need a bio break or something. Hello?
Yes, sir.
So it is 12:22. We meet at 12:30. Okay. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we'll take a 5-minute break. We'll meet at 12:28 rather. But you know, I know people will take 2-3 minutes to gather up and everything. So let's take a let's meet at 12:28. Correct? Yeah, I have some interesting things up there now. Thank you. Yeah, hello, we're all back.
Yes, sir.
So I just got myself a cup of coffee actually. So by the way, whatever I'm speaking, does it make sense to all of you? I hope I'm making a logical connect.
Yes, sir.
So Deepti, what happens now, let me come to, you know, because this is very important, role of IT. I said Deepti, and you put a question that you want more clarity on what do you mean by single point of data, okay, single view of data. What happens is, in a large organization, you saw Alibaba, you know about Walmart, you know about Reliance Fresh. It is not possible, or generally organizations, they collect data, or the, you know, the data agents collect data from various source systems. Okay. And the problem happens when these data are not reconciled together. For example, your material system, material module might be having a lot of data that is not passed on to the sales staff. They don't know that what is the data that is that material that is lying unused, right? Or for that matter, your compliance and regulatory data is not visible. Just a second. Okay, so yeah, the trick is, I'm audible to everyone, right, Deepti?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the trick is regulatory compliance. That data is not visible to the management. The material data, it is not visible to the procurement part. The procurement, for example, you know, if you are in a car company, there is a lot of procurement data that happens to metal exchanges, raw material prices, that data is not visible to the production department. One of the roles of IT in supply chain management is to bring all of data together, reconcile them, and make it visible to the organization as a whole. So as you see here, there is a lot of operational systems, ERP, customer relationship management, and flat files. Because as I said, I was working with a, you know, as part of my job in early part of my career, I was working with an automobile company where, you know, it was, I cannot name that organization, but it was a very large company. You cannot imagine, across the globe, they were managing their prices, metal prices, because they dealt with raw metal. You have to deal with sheet metal, right? If you're an automobile company, you have to deal with sheet metal. So they were managing their sheet metal prices and tracking them only on Excel sheet globally. So the job of a role of IT is to extract the data from all these systems, transform them to a single format, and load it to a data warehouse. How many of you have heard of data warehouse before? What is the difference between a database and a data warehouse? All of you must have heard about database, but what is a data warehouse?
Data warehouse is this, jisme sare data upload ho, but database mein basic data hi hame milega.
Exactly. So you are pointed. So database is, you know, where there is row-wise records. But data warehouse is equivalent to a warehouse of a manufacturing plant or an inventory organization. Warehouse means everything, every information. Data warehouse means every information is organized in a logical manner for easy interpretation and extraction. So to give a real-time analogy, if any one of you is exposed to an actual material warehouse, database is like a single cupboard in a big warehouse. And warehouse is the entire warehouse where, you know, class A, class B, and class C of materials are stored. You know, the extraction is done in a phased manner. There are, you know, forklift trucks which go around and derive material for you at your will. So data warehouse is the father of database in the sense it contains many databases, their queries, methods to extract data, data lineage, data metadata, all the aspects of data are stored in a data warehouse. So when you talk about role of IT, the major role of IT is to compile together the many sources of data in a supply chain management system, the operational data, the flat files, the CRM files, stage it, extraction, transformation, and loading. Stage it in the sense, bring it to a common place and store it into a data warehouse for further reporting, online analytics, and dashboard and business intelligence applications. So, as I said, the next step of data, you know, storing data through IT systems is creating data warehouses. And when you create data warehouses, you move yourself one step closer to creating business intelligence. Okay? And that is the role of IT. Futuristic IT is to take you from just automating systems to collecting data, to storing that data and making business intelligence so that you can take supply chain management systems across the supply chain. I'll give you a real-time example. In Corona times, okay, I'll give a real-time example. I have a friend who is in, P&G, Procter & Gamble. They had an intelligence system which could tell them where the, using, you know, they had a visibility from the material department, ERP department, customer relationship department, and a dealer distribution intelligence, that where there will be a higher need for biscuits and where there will not be a higher need of biscuits in the view of lockdowns. And using this business intelligence, they use their transport management to realign their biscuit supply, you know, their biscuits and health drink supply to those areas where the demand for biscuits should be more. And a key role to play there was the role of business intelligence, which was because they had a common platform of, common platform for staging data from various sources. Iti, am I able to convey you the importance of having a single view of data here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so single view of data is very important, and IT and IS systems, especially extraction, transformation, and loading system, which is a key part of data warehouse, has got a major role to play in creating a single view of data in a supply chain management system. Okay? How to use data warehouse to boost SCM profitability? You take advantage of cloud-based technology so that everybody is able to view your data. Make sure that a data warehouse is accessible to data dashboarding tools. Eliminate paper-based systems. Use RFID. Use radio frequency identification systems or barcodes to automate, to eliminate paperwork, electronic data interchange, and leverage external resources and experts to enhance the data warehouse. Because as Mallikarjun sir said here, I think someone also said, today, IT in supply chain management is such that every person, the mechanical engineer or the civil engineer or the procurement manager, cannot say, I don't have anything to do with IT. No. His domain knowledge is very important in designing the IT system. So if you're designing the IT system of a supply chain management system, your role is to bring in the domain experts on board to decide the business rules, to find out how you'll extract and transform the data, and how the data can be positioned in a way which is useful for the end user. That is how disparate experts, disparate external resources can add value to your IT system. I spoke about Alibaba. I wanted to show that new video to you. But you know, the Alibaba's vision is have a digital vision for your SCM IT. I spoke in the beginning, there is the only role of IT in a supply chain management is at the center. That is why Alibaba is such a big success, because all their processes, all their visions is centered around digital. If the business is not digital, Alibaba is not into that business. I'll just showcase one of their, End of the day, my screen is visible to all?
Yes, sir.
They're servicing consumers, but everywhere, logistics and supply chain management, financial services, cloud intelligence and data technology, online sales, data-driven products, all are centered around how do I use data? How do I use digital technology to monetize the data that I have? Or the data that I collect, okay? That's the success of Alibaba Group. I'll just speak about one more case study before I get into a video. Parker Hannifin Corporation is one more corporation. It's an American company specializing in motion and control technologies. They had multiple businesses. They were not getting single view of data. The material flow was disparate. They never know what material. In United States, pata nahi kahan pe material rehta tha, kahan pe procurement hota tha. Just a second. Okay, so there are 101 divisions in Parker Hannifin Corporation. So they created an integrated e-commerce platform delivering seamless ordering experiences, and you boost satisfaction due to which sales are up. So using IT, the major role of IT in supply chain management is to work as an unifier, okay, to create a unified dashboard to see your materials, okay, to create intelligence out of your data. It turned, as I said, it turned complexity into opportunity, because there was a complexity, it used IT to create it into an opportunity for you. I will just show one video, because I work with IBM a lot, so I'll just showcase one video. It's a very important one. I'll just change this. Oh, my charger. Okay,
I think it all starts from the smell. Opening up a bag of coffee and getting that first whiff. You're intrigued, you want to understand it, and once you start...
Yes, sir.
Start on that journey, you can travel the world through your cup of coffee.
Coffee is in my blood. I'm the fifth generation in my family who is a coffee farmer. My grandfather always told me that coffee, it's not only a business, it's a social activity. We have hundreds of people that depend on us.
For me, the future of coffee is traceability. Traceability means having the visibility to know, was this coffee sourced in a responsible and sustainable way? In many producing countries, the price of coffee today is below their cost of production. And I think as consumers, we want farmers to be taking care of the environment. But if they don't have economic viability, it's impossible to ask them to do those things.
Our work here is sustainable. Our farm is sustainable. But I don't know if our work is really seen around the world. With blockchain, our consumers can see that we are sustainable.
We're able to take data from the blockchain and show the consumer the journey that their coffee has taken, and they're actually able to make a contribution to the farmer or to the farmer's communities. Farmer Connect is an industry-driven initiative that's using technology like digital identity and blockchain to drive digital connectivity from the farm to the consumer.
The coffee industry is a very complex ecosystem. You have the farmers, you have processors, you have exporters, importers, roasters, and then the consumers. Farmer Connect connects all the players with the right information in every step of the value chain.
When I was trying to pick a technology partner, I wanted somebody who was truly committed to blockchain. IBM Food Trust was one of the inspirations for the work that they were doing with supermarkets and being able to have instant recalls. Food Trust had already been proven, so it accelerated the speed at which we could get to a production blockchain. At the same time, knowing that we have IBM behind us, the support of the predominant company in blockchain, allows us to engage consumers in a more meaningful way, and they know that their data truly is going to be secure.
The world is changing. The only way we can continue is by getting the support of the industry.
with a unique opportunity to provide to the consumer a new enriching experience, which is going to grow the entire coffee market and benefit everybody. That's where the real power of blockchain becomes unlocked.
Yeah, so how many of you saw this? You were able to understand what I was telling, what the company organization was trying to do? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, end-to-end seamless connection using blockchain.
Yes. See, there is a social, yes, sir. Because there is a social message here. In fact, why I showed this is 2 days back, you know, yesterday or day before was Handloom Day, National Handloom Day. Are you aware, anyone?
Today
is National Handloom Day, yes. Government of India is working on an initiative called as a Handloom Token. Okay, it'll very soon come up. So, for example, you are used, I'll talk about Odisha. I think most of us are from Odisha. I don't know. I'm just making an assumption.
In Telangana,
they have done it. Malikarjun, sir, please explain. I want you to tell. Yes, please. Tell me.
Tell KTR us. KTR has initiated last year only. And the government is taking, already taken IT initiative. And anywhere throughout the world, the weavers can sell the products. Online.
No, that is not the only one, sir. The advantage there is that suppose I buy a sari, okay, today I can, you know, what happens, I remember these poor handloom weavers, they don't have information, right? And they spend, at least I know in terms of saris that are made in handlooms in Odisha, these poor people, they spend hours, creating one single handloom sari. And because they do not know what is the end price of their products, the middlemen usually cheat them. They hardly get 20 to 30% of what is the end price of that product, which is extremely unfair to them. So the government of India, based on this coffee, whatever you saw using blockchain technology, there will be a single tag which will be inserted in that sari or that handloom product. And all you have to do is to, you know, kind of a indestructible QR code. By using that QR code, I'm in a call. By using the call, indestructible QR code. I'm sorry, I got some disturbance. I'm extremely sorry for that. By having an indestructible QR code, I can trace what is the origin of that sari. Hello, am I making sense?
Yes, you are correct. Already this has been done by Telangana government.
And by doing that, I can actually, I realize that, you know, this is responsible consumerism. Suppose I realize that I bought a sari for 10,000 rupees and due to certain reason, the main manufacturer of that person has only got 500 rupees for that sari. I, out of my own conscience, of course, I cannot eliminate all the middlemen. I can make a contribution to that particular handloom weaver. I can pay him 2,000 rupees because I know that I am getting a sari for 10,000 rupees, but somewhere down the line, his labor is not respected. So when you are bringing in visibility to supply chain management data, you are not only boosting your profitability, you are not only creating a responsible supply chain management, but you are also creating a responsible society, responsible consumer culture. So there is, you know, as I say, there is an altruistic motive to creating a transparent and collaborative supply chain management system, which is only possible by bringing in IT and information systems to the center stage of it. So I'll pause here. I'll stop here rather. Open for questions. I think I have 5 more minutes. That's a message I wanted to leave this session with.
Yes, this has already been done by Telangana government, by KTR, textile minister, and Ivanka Trump has already praised, given an appreciation letter to Telangana government. Now so, government of India is following.
Yeah, I know that. So this is a beautiful initiative. I understand. And in fact, I admire KTR at this point of time. So, so thank you. Thanks, Mallikarjun, sir. So I hope I made a sense to all of you. Thanks for this session. Are there any questions?
Yes, sir, it was wonderful. We enjoyed.
Thank you, sir. Are there any questions?
Thank you so much, sir. It was a wonderful, interactive and amazing session.
Thank you, ma'am. Are there any questions?
Not yet.
Okay, thank you, all are cleared. And thank you, sir.
Okay, someone is asking a question on SAP. What is accelerated SAP?
Sir, one thing.
Thank you.
Hello. Sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, so what you are telling, blockchain will totally replace this EDI. What is this thing happening?
It will not replace EDI. It will not replace EDI. It will complement EDI. I'll add one because you said blockchain is not a replacement for EDI. Blockchain will make EDI more powerful, more transparent, and more permanent. In fact, it will make it permanent forever.
Okay,
so you can read about blockchain and how blockchain is helping in financial transparency and stability. Another topic for another day. I'll not delve into it deeper. It'll take more half an hour or 1 hour for that matter. I've given my email. You can find me out through this email on LinkedIn as well as mail. I'll be happy to answer any questions later on. I must thank all of you for listening to me so patiently. Mallikarjun sir, Deepti, Jayashri, always so wonderful participants here. I also knew about Telangana initiative. So, these forums are not a one-to-many forum. It's a many-to-many forum. So today I know that, Telangana government has already pioneered what government of India is doing tomorrow, going to do tomorrow. That's a beautiful thing. And so I hope I have told you, I've impressed on you that, supply chain management has got a larger social construct, larger social responsibility. And the only way, I must say, with less modesty, the only way to make supply chain management more socially responsible is through employing IT. Okay. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much, everyone.
One thing I want to add. Supply chain management is going to even for Mars. In between space station, they will use for docking different things. And whenever they want, they can go for Moon or Mars. That's a new concept, new age or say space concept.
Correct there.
Thank you.
So that's all about me. Bye.
Thank you, sir, for your nice deliberation and making the session more interactive and friendly session.
Thank you.
Thank you all the participants. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Bye. Have a happy weekend.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. You can send me feedback or questions, anything over my LinkedIn, which is searchable through my email ID or my email also. Thank you. Bye.
Sure.
Or through, or better through Pratap, sir.
Yes.
Thank you.